So I do believe that there is a place for AI, and obviously AI has become a game changer. I'm working with one of my clients right now on an AI project where they have an AI system that is going through hundreds of hours of my training that's been recorded. And this AI system is learning from our training and learning from the Q&A and learning how people interact with the training. And so that's going to be an AI based on, you can just imagine people ask a question, or how do I do this, or how do I write a scope, or what is, how do I write a work breakdown structure, or how do I create a cost estimate? So based on the training I've done, it's creating this wealth of knowledge that will be more interactive than just the hit play like you're watching a YouTube video. So how does that help us be a better project manager though? So AI, we're just seeing all sorts of things bubble up in the project management world with AI. Streamlining our processes, analyzing data, being better at predicting outcomes. So for example, let's go back to streamlining our processes. One of the biggest time sucks in project management is waiting for approval, waiting for sign-off. Waiting time is wasted time. Waiting time is billable time. So you think about your team that's idle while we're waiting for a decision to be made. Well, we have some abilities, or what I foresee AI doing, having some abilities to make decisions automatically based on thresholds of data that we put in. Analyzing data, so you think about risk, all of our identified risk and probability and impact, expected monetary value, we could have AI create a model based on the risk distribution in the project. So if we get past this risk, your likelihood of success goes from 80% to 90%. Or if you get past this risk, your likelihood of success increases to this amount, to this percentage. So we can input that data. We have Monte Carlo simulation that AI could take advantage of. And then we could predict outcomes, just like I was talking about there with risk or issues. Or we could play what if scenarios. What if we miss this deadline for the milestone? What does that do to our roadmap moving forward? What does that do to the likelihood of success for the project? What will that mean as far as creating a could have or should have deliverables? If we miss milestones, or if XYZ happens at this point in the project and we have to be done by a particular date, what are these values, what are these requirements would we drop from scope in order to hit that date? So there are variables that we can put into AI to help us predict outcomes. Now, on a much more accessible basis, I've done this, I've worked with project managers that have been doing this, probably you have as well, where they're using just very simple ChatGPT to write things that go into a project plan. So you think about that, you can now create reports that you don't write to give to people so they don't read. So how many times do we know that we create reports but nobody reads it because they ask us in an email or a phone call what's going on in the project? I just sent you the report, why didn't you read it? So now we can have AI write it for us, and they can have AI read it on that end. But we can use ChatGPT just to create some simple project elements to speed up the process. Now we could also use ChatGPT, and one of the things that I love to do with ChatGPT is for data analysis, that I can go into ChatGPT and say, write me a visual basic script to do XYZ in Excel. So I can open up that VB editor and drop that script in and use that little VB code in an Excel project to build out a dashboard. So there's all sorts of things that we can leverage ChatGPT with. So these are the three big things that I see: streamlining processes, analyzing data, and helping us predict outcomes. Now all of these have one thing in common. Someone has to give the data to AI. So is that pulling it from like an API? Is that pulling it from a system somewhere like Microsoft Project Server or SharePoint or whatever you're using? It has to pull it from somewhere, but somebody at some point has to enter the data. So that's why I say that people are still going to have to be involved. We can do AI automation and project management Like I was just talking about using ChatGPT to generate reports or to help automate Excel activities with VB script or to write some code, optimizing our resource allocation. It can just speed up time for repetitive tasks. One of the things that I say all the time in my organization is that if you're doing the same type of work over and over and over and over, that's ideal for a script. That's ideal for a macro, or use ChatGPT to help automate that by writing a little script, PowerShell or what have you. And then giving some real-time insights into what's happening in the project, where we can enter data, and then based on that data we enter, so you can imagine our cost that we've spent to date, the percentage of work we've done to date, the utilization of resources. Based on that, it can create a snapshot and give us an insight of likelihood of success or likelihood to hit a target date. So any of those, we're going to see more and more, I believe, of AI automating that type of work in our projects. EI, though, is where we really can't automate that. We really can't have a piece of software do EI for us. Don't you hate it when you're on a website somewhere? Like, just go look at a car dealership website and they have a little chat bot that comes up, and it's always some handsome dude or some good looking lady. And they're like, oh, how can I help you with this Kia? Or I know all of you, how can I help you with this Mercedes? And it's like, you know, it's fake. You know, it's not really that guy, you know, this little smiley with their headphone there helping us out. It's a chat bot. It's not real. There's no genuine connection in interacting with that thing, that piece of software. Emotional intelligence is the ability to understand and regulate my emotion, and the ability to understand, to have empathy and insight, to have those paradigm shifts, to understand where others are coming from that we interact with. So emotional intelligence is understanding the why behind certain behavior. Emotional intelligence is significant in project management and really in all aspects of your life, because we need collaboration. We have to work with others. Others have to get involved. I say that 90% of a project is communication. The best project managers, in my experience, are people that can communicate well. Now, I don't mean people that communicate a lot. I mean people that communicate well. I worked with one project manager that they would just talk and talk and talk and just talk people into submission. In fact, he knew he had the problem, and so he joined a group for people who talk too much. It was called On and On and On. Little joke there. You never know if that joke's gonna play if I can't see you. So there you have it. But communication's a big part about effective communication. And then we need that idea of team cohesion. If we think about how does a team become cohesive? Well, one, the most obvious way is over time, by having those shared experiences and by having that experience from the start or from previous projects of how we work together, and we get to know each other, we need to really know each other and how we can communicate effectively and work side by side. If we think about the Tuckman's ladder of team development, that when people first come together in forming, we have those just initial meetings with our team where we get to know each other, we talk with each other a little bit. We're all here to take on this endeavor. That's forming. There's not a whole lot accomplished in forming. It's just you're learning about one another and about the project. And from forming, then, we grow into storming. We're storming, we might have a little bit more heated conversation, or we have different people expressing their opinion on how we're gonna get things done. And sometimes that can become a little heated. So storming is, yeah, the team is kind of jockeying for position, who's gonna lead, who's gonna follow, who feels really strongly about a certain requirement or an approach to get the work done. And then we graduate from there and we go into norming, where things begin to settle down, people accept their roles, accept their position in the project, and who's gonna lead and who's gonna follow, they accept that. And then we start to get to cohesion, where we move into performing, where people are working well together, they're getting things done, and they are moving towards that desired future state. When we go into performing, it doesn't mean that we're all best friends, although that often happens, but it means that we can work as adults. And that's a great example of emotional intelligence, about how to interact with one another, how to be professional, how to understand and read the room, if you will, about where people are coming from, about the temperatures of people's attitudes during different parts of the project. And then we can go back down the ladder based on changes or shifting from different phases of the project. You can go back down the ladder back into a storming or norming based on what's happening. You could even go back to forming if people come and join the group, because it kind of disrupts that dynamic. So the importance of emotional intelligence, we have to think about how do we navigate the dynamics here. If you think about stakeholders, and we have a stakeholder engagement matrix, or their attitude towards the project. So you have people that are for it, people that are against it, people that are neutral, people that don't know about it, those mystery stakeholders. That's all the dynamics, their attitude, their perspectives, their understanding of what the project aims to achieve. And that's where you have those folks that are, they're against the project, or they want to put their pet requirements into the project. That's where we start getting into those conflicts and the politics and the power. Those people that are, they have a high amount of authority and a high amount of legitimacy up in that upper quadrant, as we think about those stakeholders, and as opposed to people that have a low amount of power and a low amount of urgency. Sometimes this is our trouble area, but these are the people that we have to keep happy. So we have to resolve conflicts and work together, and to be able to understand, to really listen, to have that active listening, and to understand what people are telling us, and to understand sometimes the underlying meaning, effective listening, as to why they're saying what they say or why they're behaving a certain way. And then part of emotional intelligence with our team, and to some extent with our stakeholders that aren't on the team, we have inspiration, the ability to get people excited, to see the business value, to see that vision that we're working towards. And we want to motivate our team, we want to motivate them to do the work. It's always easier to want to do the work than to have to do the work. So by motivating, to have some intrinsic motivation, where they're excited about the opportunity, excited about what this is going to bring about, is very valuable for our team. And then you want to engage, to maintain or improve upon that stakeholder engagement.